This week, John Wick and Sarah Connor review Kevin Michael Richardson reprising his role of iconic space opera gangster Jabba the Hutt in Guillermo del Toro's Jabba. Filmmaking maestro Martin Scorsese tackles the Marvel Universe with Brutus. And Glenn Powell and Sydney Sweeney star in the romantic comedy Anyone But You. It's all up next on the newly minted Wick and Connor at the Cinema. Kevin Michael Richardson voicing Jabba the Hutt and fantasy filmmaking maestro Guillermo del Toro's latest opus, Jabba. Just one of five big holiday releases we'll be reviewing this week on Wick and Connor at the Cinema. A retread of an idea based on the classic film review series Siskel and Ebert, hosted by the late and great Gene Siskel and Roger Ebert. May they rest in peace. My film buddy on the aisle, Sarah, with me and our executive producer of the show, Jordan Richards, thought it would be a worthy entry into the world of film to present two much beloved film characters taking up the reins, so to speak, to bring back a fun-loving tone once felt from the past series spoken of. And like Danny DeVito once said from the Oscar-winning LA Confidential,
"Nothing too original, 'cause hey, this is Hollywood."
I'm John Wick of the John Wick movies.
And I'm Sarah Connor of the Terminator films. All right, with five movies up ahead, let's get into it all. Our first film is Jabba, and it's rollicking good time from start to finish. It follows three decades in the Hutt mob in a galaxy far, far away. For those of you not born on planet Earth, Jabba the Hutt is a space slug gangster within the much-famed and lauded Star Wars films franchise universe series. Oscar-winning director Guillermo del Toro tackles this the franchise's first R-rated entry. If that were not iconic enough in of itself, what I suspect will become as iconic in time as the film's supremely well-structured storytelling. Much like beloved crime pictures such as Goodfellas and Pulp Fiction, an expertly interwoven non-linear approach is applied here which keeps us on the edge of our seats from the get-go. As in this scene here where Oscar winner Javier Bardem is notorious bounty hunter and henchman for crime boss, Jabba himself, Crackus Crawn, reflects on events that are to transpire later on in the movie, involving Jabba hiring Crackus to rub out a corrupt cop on Tatooine, Nate Taro, Ethan Hawke, who Jabba looks to dethrone so that he can control all crime on the planet.
Yes, Kachong. Kawawoki. Kasoyari kui rato kanki kungu bang.
Do you see me?
That scene inspired from and also reminiscent of John Bruman's classically and unconventionally edited Point Blank. While here we are introduced to a new relationship entering Jabba's life.
Who becomes Jabba's 15th stripper wife, Belly Telly, in an engaging performance,
Coming in at a tight 115 minutes, Jabba manages to never wear out its welcome and has you leaving the cinema wanting more and feeling satisfied all the same. In this new series of ours, not to completely rip off Mr. Siskel and Ebert, instead of giving thumbs up thumbs down reviews, we've decided to go with our own rendition of a green light red light recommendation system. Green obviously meaning go see, and red to refrain from going of course. With a possible yellow also coming up at times to indicate day, jaywalk at own your risk, if you wanna risk it. Jabba's a solid green for me. Go see it in theaters before he shows up on Disney Plus. It's worthy of your time to see the event of the film on the big screen for as long as he's still there.
It's a green light for me too, Sarah. Beyond all the things that you've mentioned, I would also like to single out Kevin Michael Richardson's lead performance here. It is my hope that come Oscar voting time, the Academy doesn't overlook him for a Best Actor nod. I know it would be a first if he were to get it for a voice performance, but since we're still trying to get our fellow stunt performers noticed as well, this boy can dream about both, so he will continue to do so. And before we close this one out, to further add to your recommendation of going to see this one in theaters, I'm sure it's already a flurry upon the interweb, but to further entice and not give away in full, the cocaine sequence is as equal to Goodfellas's similar sequence of events towards its end.
Correct, you are on both accounts. Good, sir.
Glad to see we're in agreement. Alright, up next we have Brutus. A new documentary directed by Martin Scorsese where he tackles, in part, the contact that the planet, the title of the movie, made with us here on Earth back in January of 2022. In other parts, the film maestro explores how Brutus isn't that interested in making movies with Marvel, but is interested in making movies with Marty and others, such as, for example, our very own executive producer of our proceedings here, our boss, Jordan Richards. As Brutus made contact with us, we discovered that 99% of all people, both real and fictional, go to the realm of the planet upon our earthly departure here, and apparently everything on Brutus is all Shangri-La and potato chips with liquor too. And even more than that, you can get whatever you want whenever you want it. There's time and space enough for everyone on it too. No problems and no be careful what you wish for utopia conundrum out of a Twilight Zone episode. If you want to be young and in your prime doing whatever it is you want to do, or fester alone in a room to remind you yourself of what it was once like to be human, you can do that too. Like John Woo from Hard Boiled says in the movie, life should be about having fun. I'm Brutus, you may have your cake and eat it too. If, of course, you're a part of the 99%, that is. Which the film is cryptic about, as we discover there's no clear-cut answer for us Earthlings unless maybe one day we get there ourselves. But one thing it is not cryptic about is how many fictional characters inhabit the place. It is absolutely mind-boggling, the number. Even if a character, say, doesn't die in a book you're reading, since the book has been written and exists, once the book is done, that confirms the death. So to speak, of everything and everyone in the book. Here the first Ron Burgundy, from the first script of Anchorman, The Legend of Ron Burgundy, asks us what do we think of the song that he and others got voted on to win and become a new planet anthem for Brutus and our Earthlings 2003.
Now you decide.
The Star Spangled Yawner, or this groovy tune by Bill Withers.
Feel is their appointed duty.
Here's our very own Jordan Richards further explaining some mysteries of the far-off planet.
National security all over the world is trying to contact with these guys so they can actually, you know, affect Brutus somehow. But, like, can't affect Brutus, and luckily we human beings, 99% of us, can only get there if, you know, we ask him the other yonder to get there.
And getting some of Marvel's thoughts on them being somewhat excluded by the planet follows.
Why is the Incredible Hulk green? Who put the X in the X-Men? And why the heck does Spider-Man wear those pajamas?
We're gonna have to stop.
Putting it as bluntly as that, in turn, we're somewhat forced to be a tad cryptic ourselves with our reviews here. For all of the mystery that continues to surround Brutus for the almost now 2 years we've been in contact with him, the film does manage to give us more info on the planet than has ever been revealed before. However, though, the film's Earth distributor of TriStar Pictures are banking on box office bonsai over the holiday season, so mum's been the forced-upon word on us here. All that being said, Brutus the movie is an overall highly enlightening and entertaining exploration of a distant planet many of us wish to grace with our presence one day, perhaps. Alongside Mr. Scorsese's Killers of the Flower Moon, the living film legend continues to have a banner year with that film and his cleverly creative-made doc of Brutus here, too. Big green light for me, Sarah.
Me too, John, if the man doesn't pick up at least one Oscar for either of his two films this year, that just ain't gonna be right. One of the things I absolutely loved about this film is hearing from a spattering of the fictional characters covered and how some of them got into filmmaking upon their arrival of the planet. I look forward to seeing Drexel Spivey's rendition of Peter Bogdanovich's Targets in the near future, just to name one film selection to come from the planet.
I as well, Miss Connor. I as well. From Drexel, from Brutus, from a Tony Scott film, we go next to T. Scott's brother's remake of his own film, starring again our own Jordan Richards and Dave Chappelle in Ridley Scott's The Last Boy Scout. Coming up next on Wick and Connor at the Cinema, after the break.
I want to show you something. This is the money we could save by switching from fresh-packed California crushed tomatoes to concentrated tomato paste.
I want to show you something, too. I got a new door. Go! Go take a look at it.
Nobody uses better ingredients than Little Caesars. Like fresh-packed California crushed tomatoes. Pick up a large hot and ready classic for just $5.
Pizza, pizza.
Guy in the closet. Yeah, that's right. Sometimes you forget I'm a detective. See, there's a fog in the shower over there. But your hair's not wet. There's no one underneath the bed, so I figured you must have tossed him in the closet when you heard my key in the lock a day early. So, who's the guy in the closet?
You want me to open the closet, Joe? I'll do it, okay? And then we'll both know that you're psycho. Is that what you want, huh?
No.
Thank you.
The door stays shut. What I am going to do is, I'm going to count to three. I'm going to shoot a bullet through that door. Jesus. You can stop me anytime by telling me the truth. One.
Call your shrink, Joe. Call him and tell him that you're losing it.
Truth is a beautiful thing. Two.
How dare you come into this house?
Three.
No!
Look, Joe.
Keeping her warm for me, Mike?
Enticing the movie definitely opens. That was again our boss, Jordan Richards, Avril Lavigne in one part of a dual role that she plays in the film, and friend of the film's director Ridley Scott, Leonardo DiCaprio appearing in cameo form as favor for the filmmaker. Here Scott has taken his late great brother Tony's original film, The Last Boy Scout, starring Bruce Willis and Damon Wayans, and redone it in the modern day, again with our boss, Jordan in the Bruce part and Dave Chappelle now in the Wayans part. He's also switched up the sport of football from the original film to basketball for this modern-day remake. The film's script for the remake is also written by the same writer who gave us the original Boy Scout, Shane Black. Richards plays bitter and surly detective Joe Hallenbeck, who at the onset of the film is hired by fellow detective DiCaprio, seen in the scene just shown, to she'll provide some security surveillance for a being threatened upon porn star named Corey Sid Schult in a star-making performance. Albeit a small role, she's one to watch coming up within the ranks. Her boyfriend is disgraced NBA player for the Los Angeles Lakers, Jimmy Dix, played by Chappelle. Later on, the two in question, that's Richards and Chappelle, will find themselves dealing with corrupt officials trying to legalize sports gambling like in the original film. But here in this scene, the two men meet for the first time on a porn set of Corey's.
Oh, so you know who I am?
I know who you are. James Pinball Dix of the Los Angeles Lakers, number 14, most valuable player, seasons 2017 to 2018. Also allegations of drug abuse, gambling too. Another sad, tragic tale of wasted youth.
Now you're starting to piss me off.
And domestic bliss also continues to not find Richards. He'll end back here where we see him argue with daughter Darian, again with Avril Lavigne in the dual role of both mother and daughter.
Your mother called me a when?
On the phone with Uncle Jay.
Oh, I'm a but Uncle Jay, there's a real stand-up guy. Guy cheats on his taxes, wonder why he's not in jail.
Because he doesn't
Darian. Go to bed.
You know, for $50, you could pay a guy to pull a fingernails out one by one.
That much I'd rather do it myself.
If you're a fan of the original and or simply love film noir and can also appreciate an aggressive modern-day spin on the said genre, this flick's for you. And it was for me too. Like the original, the tone is the key here. If you can't handle that heat, then you might as well get out of the kitchen. This film's type of humor is very heavy-handed if you can't let your hair down and put your feet up to enjoy. So just be forewarned before going in, so that if you're in the latter group that you don't try and ruin the party for those of us in the former that do enjoy it. And before I fully cap off here, let us focus on the solid performances all around on this one too. Beyond Sid Schult, as mentioned earlier, Richards and Chappelle give career-defining performances, and I'm not saying that because Richards is my boss but because it's true. One who thinks they may know Jordan may think, can he really play a surly badass? He seems somewhat sensitive and quiet. Clearly you've never seen him on a bad day. Richards is 100% believable in this role, as is Chappelle. One who doesn't always do many movies proves he should do more because he's certainly one of the more interesting screen personalities to grace the silver screen in the modern day. And last but certainly not least, let us not forget to fawn over Canada's very own Ms. Lavigne. In her dual role as both mother and daughter, she should certainly rack herself up a Best Actress nomination come Oscar time. While Sid Schult should score Best Supporting Actress, and our leads of both Richards and Chappelle scoring Best Actor nominations too. Full green light here for me. I really dug this one. And what say you, Wick?
Since you nailed it on all the acting fronts, with the exception of Jude Law taking up the original's Tyler Negron's villainous turn, he gave me as many chills as Negron did, some supporting actor nod should go Law's way as well. I'd like to hail the film's screenwriter and director a bit too. Director R. Scott pays loving homage to his brother Tony's early 90s actioner. Both films would serve up as a great double bill played together, something more that may be mentioned as of later on in the episode. Like Scorsese, R. Scott has two films out this year, his Napoleon drama and Boy Scout here. Both Sarah and I weren't as warmed by Napoleon as we were Boy Scout, no offense against Neo, just wasn't our bag. But all that being said, where Scorsese should at the very least get one if not two nominations for his films this year, Ridley certainly deserves notice for his Boy Scout. Like his brother Tony said of his and his brother's films when comparing the two filmmakers' styles together, as paraphrased quotes from Tony's IMDb page go, Ridley makes films more for prosperity, I make mine more for rock and roll. I am happy to report that a proper blending of Tony's rock and roll has been properly blended with Ridley's prosperity. And before wrapping up, not forgetting Shane Black's contributions, his script here equals that of his originals. Both can be watched separate and or together, and either experience only help enhance both films' legacies. I really dug this one too, Sarah. Full green go from me.
It's fun to agree so much after a rather wank of a year in cinema, aside from some of the better stuff like Boy Scouts remake here, of course. Okay, up next we have Deception, and it's the latest from writer-director Nancy Myers, usually known for autumn year romantic comedy, dramedy, character-driven fare like Something's Got to Give What Women Want, The Intern and The Holiday, the latter of which is in part a sort of basis for the following Deception up next here. It is a rather surprising and effective change of pace and tone for the author. Lindsay Lohan showing up again from her turn in Jabba stars alongside James Franco. The concept for this film comes from a fake trailer that Myers created for her film The Holiday, that Cameron Diaz's character in that film is a worker on in the trailer-making studio that she owns. Here Myers has decided to fully flesh out the fake trailer into a real feature film, and on this heavy green light recommended episode thus far, they just keep on coming from me for this one too. In a throwback to a kinda 1970s style 3 Days of the Condor type spy movie, here we witness at the onset of the movie Logan's character, Rebecca Green, falling into a world of intrigue when Franco's knight in shining armor, Clive Barrow, that's Clive, not Clyde, enters as a mysterious character to help her out. After that fracas leading lady and man hide out from the bad guys in a safe house, Myers' trademark talent for well-written dialogue comes up in spades in this quirky exchange here.
Thanks for putting me up for a while. I appreciate it. I don't like cats.
Why, are you dead?
And here Miss Lohan's, Rebecca, has a heated coming-to-terms discussion with the man who may or may not be her mysteriously unknown by her father, a mob lawyer for a Russian Los Angeles crime syndicate, played by Kevin Costner.
Look, Daniel, I know you may not care about what happened to me.
I don't believe that I'm...
You remember the Hemingway star, the old man of the sea? The old fisherman manages to catch his great fish. Fish so huge that he has to tie it to the side of the boat in order to get it back in. But by the time it reached the shore, fish had long since been picked apart by sharks. I don't believe that I'm involved in this campaign. Nothing was left but the skeleton.
You're pathetic!
And the hits just keep on coming after that exchange, too. The plot of the film is full of so many twists and turns it would be unfair of us reviewers here to spoil any of them for you moviegoers out there. So by choosing to save the mysteries for you to discover on your own, I'll focus on the craft of the whole thing more than the plot for your possible viewing pleasure. Myers proves she is just as adept at action as the big guns like Bigelow and Wu are, just to name two. And with her exquisite writing to boot, it's also fun to see her apply it into a genre she's not typically known for. Again, another full green light from me here. I can't believe what a really good week it's been, but I really, really like this one as much as all the others this week too thus far.
Me too, Sarah. Since I agree with you it would be wise and nice of us not to spoil the clever reveals in the film, I'll follow suit with you and concentrate more on the picture's craftsmanship as well, over revealing more of the plot. You know, we've signaled out handfuls of actors we believe shouldn't be ignored come Oscar nominations time, including their directors and writers on this episode, and I won't stop here. Both Lohan and Franco, including Costner, with Lohan having a record big League 2 film release year along with earlier mentioned filmmaking legends, Scorsese and R. Scott, all deliver up blistering performances of the utmost artful and entertaining professionalism. We can't help but sit back and simply admire their abilities. In what could have come across as a simple exercise in routine, we're instead given a seriously well-made and thought-out film that is worthy of being ranked amongst the best of classic thrillers, like your 3 Days of the Condor mentioned, Sarah, and say something like JFK 2. And again, can we simply say, Myers, Myers, Myers. She's the key ingredient for me here, as Sarah was saying, she's not known for writing and directing thrillers, and she killed it right out of the gate on her first time, I believe it is. It is very refreshing to be delightfully surprised when going to a new movie for the first time when it's as good as this one is. Big green light from me too, Sarah. If only every movie-going week could be as good as this one has been thus far.
Let us possibly not speak too soon and maybe accidentally jinx ourselves, my dear friend, as we have one more film up next. After the break, we'll be back to review Sydney Sweeney and Glenn Powell and their romantic comedy, Anyone But You.
I'm only happy when it rains. Feel good when things are going wrong. I only listen to the sound.
It's me and it's Super Dave.
I'm on a dancing jig.
Thank you.
delighting you always.
Rebecca Green was just your average 20-year-old until the father she never knew left her something she never expected.
Don't scream.
Your father left you something in his will.
I never met my father.
Well, at least now you know he was interesting.
Lindsay Lohan. James Franco. Deception.
How do you happen to have two guns?
I didn't think one would be enough.
Christmas Day.
Let's just tell everyone we're together.
What?
It could be kind of fun.
There's no way we can convince anyone we actually like each other.
Trust me. We're at a wedding, a million miles away from home. Who knows what could happen? You'll be the death of me. Convincing enough?
And the laughs just keep on coming more or less for some of the movie from there. Anyone But You is a decent enough modern-day romantic comedy you're bound to possibly find something to like about, even if you don't like it. If you're not a completely heartless bastard, I suppose. Yellow light for me here. Go at your own risk, folks.
Here, weak boy, I concur. Like the year 2023 in movies was for the most part, if you weren't a part of the small amount of exceptional work, you were either fine, okay, mediocre or bad. That's pretty much where this one lies. Within the latter somewhere depending on your opinion, not the former of exceptional, yellow light for me too. John, we got close to a full five green light go week, but not quite. Till 2024 we go. When we come back, John will present our stay-at-home pick of the week for your viewing pleasure.
Such a day as beautiful as this is. Such a day was perfect.
John and Sarah's stay-at-home pick of the week is brought to you by Half-Fuller Glass Cinemas. Why go to another theater if you can go to a Half-Fuller Glass Cinema? With three locations in the world, check them out in either Los Angeles, Florida, or Toronto. That's Half-Fuller Glass Cinemas, a place to experience exceptional movies at in style. Sarah's and my stay-at-home pick of the week is that of Tony Scott's original The Last Boy Scout, as hinted at earlier in the show. Good idea, as we were also suggesting earlier too, to watch this one as a companion piece to the Boy Scout remake. Watch this one first if you have or haven't already seen it, as it all adds to the fun for both. From surly Bruce and Damon to surly Jordan and Dave, as you start with the original's Bruce and Damon, Damon who by the way also plays a police captain in the remake, be reignited with old school 90s action proper this holiday season, as you soak in the seedy neon lights of cinematographer Ward Russell's stylish cinematography, T. Scott's adrenaline-charged action direction, Michael Kamen's contemporarily cool and soaring score, Shane Black's very funny, vulgarly written dialogue, and again, Willis's and Wayne's perfectly well-done film noir-drenched performances. If you want to stream, a Google search will inform you that you may rent her on everything from Google Play to Apple TV to Amazon Prime Video to YouTube and others. Or if you want to be like myself and Sarah, pop in a Blu-ray like ours. Or even go our boss Jordan's way and pop in a previously owned DVD copy into your player if you still have one, like us old schoolers Wick, Connor, and Richards.
And on that note, let us recap this week's many heavily green-lighted flicks on the show. Two big green lights for Guillermo del Toro's first R-rated Star Wars opus, Jabba, a highly inventive and entertaining entry into the Star Wars universe, coming in full double green again with Brutus, Martin Scorsese's second film of the year but only documentary. Both John and I feel if Scorsese doesn't pick up an Oscar for either this or his narrative feature, Killers of the Flower Moon, a crime in movie heaven will have been committed. Double green lighting again we have Ridley Scott's remake of his brother Tony's classic 90s actioner, The Last Boy Scout, with duo leads Jordan Richards and Dave Chappelle giving career-defining performances. Both John and I feel Avril Lavigne in her dual role as both mother and daughter ain't too shabby either. Another double green light scenario finds us admiring up in Nancy Meyers' radical change in direction with her very thrilling and engaging thriller, Deception. And closing out this week's four-star winning week almost across the board we have Looks, tolerably made romantic comedy, Anyone But You, coming in with the only two yellow lights on the show from John and I, Jay Walk at Your Own Risk. Folks, And that does it for this week, but join us next week when both John and I will deliver our coveted top 10 lists of the year. As stated earlier, it was a rough one at times, so here's to hoping we were able to deliver a full 10 each. Fingers crossed. I'm Sarah Connor of the Terminator Films.
And I'm John Wick of the John Wick Movies. And to classically rip off the late and great Siskel and Ebert, like our DeVito from LA Confidential says,
nothing too original, cause hey, this is Hollywood.
Until next week, the balcony is closed.